So I want to thank the organizers for inviting me today to give this talk. And today our subject is what we think a new kind of experimental biological active matter. So the nematodes Turbatrix aceti. This is a project that we started to work on around a year ago, just in February of last year, just before the pandemic. So we were obliged to interrupt it for half a year, but we restarted our experiments again in the fall of last year. And today I will present you the result of these investigations. So on this project, I work in collaboration with Professor Alice Quillin, and a lot of experiments in this for this project were done by the student Sonia McGaffigan. So first, a bit of motivation why we will want to study these nematodes. So we all know the classical definition of active matter. Active matter are particles that use internal energy to produce some work. In the classical active matter, it's self-propulsion. So the particles self-propulse and they're able to synchronize their motion to move in the same direction. Like, for example, you can see on this photo, a nice photo of a fish swarm that move in the same direction. However, we can extend this definition to some other kind of work produced from internal energy. For example, oscillations. So here is a photo of fireflies. This is a species of fireflies that live in the south of the United States. We know that fireflies produce light in a oscillatory motion, and this particular species of fireflies is able to synchronize their flashing, and so they all flash at the same time. So to study this kind of oscillators, people generally use synchronization models like Kuramoto model. However, when they study this kind of systems, even given that these bugs can move in space, nobody actually pay interest to the displacement of the particles in space. So they're considering as static particles only synchronized their oscillation. And so the question is, can we take these two kind of motion, two kind of active motion, and we'll put them in a model together? So this is something that was done theoretically several years ago by O'Keefe and collaborators in the group of Stefan Strogatz. And what they proposed is a model that includes both the position and orientation of the classical active matter, but also some oscillator and an oscillator phase of the classical oscillators. So they have this equation of the position, which of course depend on the internal energy produced, so the velocity of each particles, on the interaction between the particles, and of course some noise. So this is a classical equation of active matter. The standard example of such an equation will be the well-known Wittig model. For the oscillation, once again, for the phase, we have internally produced work that produce internal frequency of each particles. We once again have interactions and noise. A classical example of a simple equation like that will be, of course, the Kuramoto model. So the important thing here is that our positions and orientation of the particles not only depend on the position and orientation of other particles, but also on the phase of the oscillator. So they are coupled to the oscillator equation. And the same, the oscillations are coupled to the positions and orientation of the particles. So this equation put together give rise to this new kind of active matter that the authors called swarm alators. Since then, there have been several studies of different kind of these equations. Probably one interesting study is the one by Enkrug et al. They have studied a slightly different models and they have found a lot of different new states. Here, of course, the color indicates the orientation of the oscillator. And I will not enter in the details of these different states. The only state that's really interesting to us is what the author called here a moving wave state, and which is actually more correctly described as a metachronal wave. So what is a metachronal wave? This is something that is typically found in live cilia. However, to represent it better, I will show you experiments, very interesting experiments from Guhongri et al., when they actually produced artificial magnetic cilia that they're able to control. So when I say that fireflies, for example, synchronize their oscillation, they mean that they all flash at the same time. So this is a synchronization of the phase. So the phase of all the particles here, of all the cilia, is the same at all the time. So they have synchronized their phase. However, another possible type of synchronization is a identical phase different between the particles. And this kind of identical phase difference produce a moving wave of the phase. And this is why this kind of state is called a metachronal wave with a phase that moves in space and time. So biological systems that display this kind of behavior, of course, are real cilia, but also some insects and arthropods. In this example is the arthropod millipede. All the millipede actually display this kind of motion. So they use this metachronal wave in their legs to move on the surface. So this is probably a nicer view of the metachronal waves than typical cilia videos, as you can find. So now that we know what are sphermolators and what are metachronal waves, we can go to our system. We're studying the nematodes Turbatrix aceti, or simply T. aceti, which are commonly known under the name of vinegar eels. As their name implies, they typically live in vinegar. They are very commonly used in aquaculture to give food to small fishes. And this is why it is very easy to obtain them. You can buy them from most aquarium supply stores. And it is also very easy to grow them. When you obtain your starter culture, you just put it in a solution of vinegar. You put some slices of apple as a food source, and you wait several weeks, better a couple of months, for your solution to become very dense, and then you can perform experiments on it. So here I'll show you a video which is slowed down by 50% of individual nematodes moving. And you can see that these nematodes, to move, they undulate their body, which means that these nematodes, like sphermolators, possess all three possible degrees of freedom. They have their position, they have their orientation, and they also have their internal oscillatory state. So this is really an example of sphermolators. So you can see that in this solution, we have both adult specimen, big ones, and some small ones. We do not perform any control of population. So nematodes at all stage of maturity can be found on our solution. However, in the collective state that I will show you later, only adult nematodes are in this collective state, and small nematodes are typically just ejected out of this state. So the typical value for these adult nematodes, the length is around 1 to 2 millimeter. The diameter is 50 times smaller, 20 to 40 micrometers. A typical speed is of 0.4 millimeter per second, which means that these swimmers evolve at intermediate Reynolds number from 0.1 to around 1. This is in contrast to most of other kind of active matter like bacteria, algae, actin, which evolves at very low Reynolds number. That means that if we want to study the hydrodynamics of these nematodes, we cannot neglect nonlinear terms in the Navier-Stokes equation, and we cannot neglect the time dependence in this equation. So this is also something that could be interesting to study this system. So the typical oscillation frequency of the nematodes is around from 4 to 8 hertz. The majority of nematodes oscillate around 6 hertz, 5 to 7 hertz, we'll say like that. If I look at the individual nematodes in time, and here the colored beads correspond to the position of the body at different times, and you can see actually at the bottom where we have a sinusoidal wave that the position of the body can be very nicely fitted by a sinusoidal, except probably the tail of the nematodes. So these nematodes are really a very nice example of oscillatory particles. Of course, what interests us today are the collective states of the nematodes. And to study these collective states, we take our solution of nematodes. We put them in a centrifuge for several minutes, typically from 3,000 to 5,000 turns per minute. And at the end, we obtain a very dense blob of nematodes. The typical densities that we study are from 10 to 100 nematodes per microliter, which actually correspond to a very small volume fraction of only 10 minus 2 to 10 minus 3. It's also important to note that even if you see here the density of nematodes seems to be extremely high, in reality there is plenty of food and oxygen for them inside, and they can happily be in this dense state for many days without any problems. So to study the collective state, we take this dense blob and we put it on a glass slide in a droplet, and this droplet will evaporate during time, and we will study how the nematodes behave in this droplet. So here you are, I show you a droplet of 250 microliter with initial density of around 30 nematodes per microliter, which means that inside these droplets are around 8,000 nematodes. The size of these droplets is around 1 centimeter in diameter. And so you can see that initially at the time zero, the motion of the nematodes inside the droplet is essentially random. Nothing much is happening. However, as all as majority of active matter, these nematodes, when they hit the border, they prefer to swim along the border. And of course, when they swim along the border, they oscillate at the border. And if you wait long enough, you'll see that the oscillation of individual nematodes at the border will start to synchronize, and at some time, a metachronal wave will percolate at the border, as you can see on this video, which is 20 minutes later. It's still hard to see the metachronal wave. This is because the density is not yet big enough, and the synchronization of the motion of the body is yet not perfect. But if you wait even longer, here, a hour later, we see that this nematode forms this extremely nice metachronal wave moving in one direction. One important thing to note is that you can see that this metachronal wave is moving in counterclockwise direction. In the majority of our experiments that we performed, like 70% or more than 70% of experiments, the metachronal wave is always moving in counterclockwise direction. We do not know yet the reason for this symmetry breaking, because at least from what we have studied, individual nematodes, when they swim, they don't have any asymmetry that could explain this symmetry breaking. This frequency of this particular wave is almost 7 hertz. Here, all the videos are decreased in speed by 3 times. This is a relatively high frequency. The majority of waves that we have seen are somewhere from 4 to 5 hertz. We do not yet know what select the initial frequency of the wave, but once the wave is formed, generally the frequency of the wave stay the same through the whole life of the wave. You can also see in the middle of the droplets that there is this dense cluster of nematodes in both of these droplets, in which the nematodes are very entangled. These clusters is not always observed, but very often observed. This cluster is not stable in time. It can form, it can deform, it can grow, it can shrink. Sometimes it grows so much that it actually depletes the nematodes at the border, and the metachronal wave can disappear. We do not yet know what is the physics of these clusters. We could think that this could be probably explained by the simple model of motility-induced phase separation. However, in preliminary experiments, we have seen that the appearance of these clusters is heavily dependent on the viscosity of the fluid. So probably more complicated models will be needed to explain these clusters. However, in this talk today, I will not talk about these clusters because we have not yet really studied them. So if I look at this metachronal wave under a microscope, we can see that the nematodes orient their head along the border and synchronize their motion, the motion of their body. So here for this video, the frequency of the wave is around 4.5 hertz. The typical velocity of the wave is 4 millimeters per second. What is important to note is that the nematodes are not attached to the surface. They actually move along the surface with a typical velocity of 0.1 millimeter per second. Just to remember you, we have seen previously that in the bulk, the typical velocity of the nematodes is around 0.4 millimeter per second. So these are relatively comparable. And what you can also see is that the density of the nematodes is actually very high. And we can actually show that this density, assuming that the nematodes are in 2D, is the maximum possible packing fractions that they can attain. So because they are also not that they're not oscillating perpendicular to the surface, but their oscillation are oriented at some angle, this actually slightly degrades the maximum possible density for the nematodes. But of course, because they're oriented at some angle, they can produce fluid flows, as we'll see later in the presentation. So the natural question to ask is why are they forming this metachronal wave? What are the control parameters for forming this metachronal wave? As I have said you previously, typically to form this metachronal wave, we need a density from 10 to 20, maybe 30 nematodes per macroliter. However, beyond this density, we will always observe the formation of the wave. And generally, the wave itself is not really dependent on the density of nematodes in the bulk. And what we have discovered is actually that the formation of this metachronal wave is controlled by the contact angle of the droplet. Just to remember you, the contact angle of the droplets is the angle that the liquid forms with the surface. It is initially determined by the property of the fluid and by the surface on which the droplet resides. So here on this graph, I show you the contact angle versus time for several different droplets, several different experiments with different initial volumes of the droplets going from 100 microliter up to 1 milliliter. And also with different initial contact angle and also different velocity of evaporation of the droplets. And here with a vertical line on each for each droplet, I represent the time at which the metachronal wave appear. And you can see that this time are very different. They go from several seconds to several hours for the metachronal wave to appear. However, for all the different experiments, the metachronal wave appear approximately at the same contact angle. And we have determined that this critical contact angle is around 68.5 degrees. So beyond this critical angle, there will always be a metachronal wave in the droplets. The question is, of course, why this formation of the wave is dependent on the contact angle of the droplets. So our hypothesis is for nematodes to be able to synchronize their motion, that they need to actually touch the body of each other. And in this case, they probably will be able to synchronize. So if we suppose that the contact angle of the droplets is very big, nematodes that move along the border and oscillate nearby can do it at very different angles, which means that the probability that the nematodes will touch the body of each other is relatively low. However, if the contact angle is very small, then the probability that the nematodes will be able to touch the body of each other is relatively high, and then they will be able to synchronize their motion. So this contact angle and synchronization does not only affect the order parameter, but also the density of nematodes at the border. So here on this graph, I represent you the density of nematodes that oscillate at the border versus the contact angle of the droplets for three different droplets with three different initial density of nematodes, droplets with 20 nematodes per microliter, 30, and 15 nematodes per microliter. And here on the right, I represent the same density, but divided by the bulk density of the droplets for the high contact angles. And you can see that initially, the density at the border is just proportional to the bulk density of nematodes. However, after reaching somewhere near this critical angle, the density at the border starts to grow. For this lowest density droplets, actually a metachronal wave never formed, and we see a slight increase. Then there is a large plateau in the density, and at the end, the density goes down. However, for the two droplets with a metachronal wave forming, we see that there is a sharp increase in the density, which can be explained by the synchronization. If there is a synchronization of motion between the nematodes. That means that there will be more space at the border, and which means that more nematodes will be able to go to the border. And we see that for different initial density, the final density of nematodes at an angle around 35 to 25 degree is the same. This is because, as I explained it before, they're actually reaching here the maximum possible density. It's simply impossible for them to physically put more nematodes at the border. And of course, when the contact angle becomes too small, the nematodes are not able anymore to feed there. The metachronal wave is destroyed and the density is just dropping down at the border. What is also interesting for this state is not only because this is a new kind of active matter, but also because the state can produce very strong fluid flows. So here I show you a video which is accelerated 10 times, and I have put some fluorescent particles inside, and you can see that there is a very strong fluid flow formed in the droplets with the particles and the nematodes at the middle turning with the metachronal wave. These fluid flows are actually strong enough to deform the surface of the droplets, as can be probably slightly seen here, but it's much better seen if I look at the droplet from the side. Here on this video, you see we use light to highlight the surface of the droplets, and you see that the surface of the droplets is really deformed by this metachronal wave. And we have actually also discovered that the force produced by the nematodes is strong enough to change the physics of evaporation of the droplets. Just a quick introduction on how the droplets evaporate. This typically depends on the cohesive forces between the liquid molecule, so essentially the surface tension, and the adhesive forces between the liquid molecule and the surface, so the wettability of the droplet to the surface. So if the wettability is very high and the cohesive force are relatively low, which means that when the droplets evaporate, it will want to maintain a constant diameter, a constant surface of contact, and which means that when it will evaporate, its contact angle will go down. So a typical example of such kind of droplets is water deposited on a glass surface. In the opposite case, if the cohesive force, like surface tension, is very high compared to the wetting force, that in that case, our droplets will want to maintain a minimal possible surface, which means it will try to maintain a very high contact angle, and then when it will evaporate, it will shrink its diameter. So a typical example of such kind of droplets will be the same water droplet, but now deposited on a hydrophobic surface, for example, Teflon. What I have not told you previously is that in all the experiments that I have shown you before, the droplets were deposited not on a simple glass slide, but on a glass slide that was treated with a hydrophobic PDMS solution. So for all the experiments that I have shown you previously, we will have actually expected the droplets to evaporate with a constant contact angle and a shrinking diameter. And we have seen that this was actually not the case. So here I show you another experiment where I initially deposit four different droplets on a PDMS-treated glass slide. Droplets with the highest density of nematodes that I call 100%, a droplets with half the density of nematodes, a droplets with a quarter of density of nematodes, and finally a droplets without nematodes at all. And as you see, as expected, a droplets without nematodes in a hydrophobic surface evaporate with a shrinking diameter, but it mostly maintain a constant contact angle of the droplets. In the opposite, the droplet with the nematodes essentially maintain a constant diameter throughout the whole evaporation, but it shrink its contact angle. So if I represent this on a graph here on the left, you see the contact angle as a function of time. On the right, you see the diameter of the droplet as a function of time. Here in the blue is a droplet without the nematodes. You can see that it mostly maintains a constant contact angle near 90 degrees, and its diameter is linearly shrinking in time. In the opposite, the droplets with nematodes reduce their contact angle. The more nematodes you have, the faster is the reduction in contact angle. And after reaching this critical density for the formation of wave, we can see that actually the reduction in the angle is even accelerated. Interestingly, for the diameter, we initially see a slight increase in the diameter of the droplets. We see that this is probably due to the hysteresis of the contact angle, which is facilitated by the motion of the nematodes. And we see that there is a very small shrinkage in the diameter of the droplets. From this, we can actually estimate the force produced by individual nematodes, and which we have estimated to be around 10 micronewtons per nematode. And this is actually compatible with force which were directly measured on another type of nematodes, C. elegans. And in this experiment, they measured a force approximately from 5 millinewton up to 30 millinewton per nematode. So our estimation of the force produced by our nematodes are very consistent with the force directly measured on other kind of nematodes. So in conclusion, we have seen that the nematode Turbatrix aceti is a new kind of active matter. There are sphermolators, particles that not only self-propel, but also oscillate, and which can synchronize their motion and synchronize their oscillation. They produce this very nice metachronal wave. This metachronal wave produces fluid flows, which can change the shape of the droplets, the surface of the droplets, and also this force produced by the nematodes and the fluid flows are actually capable of changing the physics of evaporation of the droplets. If you want to know more, most of what I presented to you today is in this article, in this preprint, which you can go and see. And also something that I didn't have time to talk to you about, we have a simple model for the synchronization of these nematodes, which is presented in this other article that you can also go and look at. Thank you for your attention, and I'm ready to answer your questions.
Thank you very much for the nice presentation, and I really enjoyed the videos. We have a few questions in the chat. It may be better if I just ask the audience to unmute themselves and ask the question. Rafael Petrosian, please.
Yeah, hi. So thanks for an interesting talk. So I wanted to know, does the time of the metachronal wave formation depend on the nematode density first?
So it could be. Why? Because we see here that the velocity with which the droplets evaporate depend on the density of nematodes. So the more nematodes there is, the faster will be the evaporation of the droplets, and the sooner it will reach the critical density to form the collective state. But you can also understand that the evaporation of the droplets also depend a lot on the volume of the droplets.
But let's say if they are not evaporating.
Oh, if so imagine I cover my droplets with oil, for example, to prevent them from evaporating. So if the contact angle is not sufficient to form the collective state, if the contact angle is very high, then they will never form the collective motion. And if the contact angle is small, in that case, generally the formation of the metachronal wave is extremely fast. It can sometimes take only seconds. We haven't studied exactly, but it's generally very, very fast.
Okay, maybe other question I'll ask during the informal chat. Thanks.
So we have a question from Robert Jung.
Oh, it's just a simple question. I just wanted to know if you all had studied the effects of freezing effects. I know you were looking at evaporation because it seems easier to work with the level of forces that was going on in the droplet. But I was wondering if there's any experimentation that was done in changes of freezing patterns with the droplet, if you're looking at that as well.
Okay, what do you exactly mean by freezing?
Oh, just like if there's any effects of, you know, dropping the temperature around it and seeing how, you know, the changes to the way the droplet might freeze with external conditions based on nematode movement or the way that the wave dissipates.
So the question is, as I understand, if the temperature affect the motion of nematodes?
Well, I know it is, but I'm just more curious about whether or not you studied the effects of freezing on the droplet with these concentrations and movements. And if not, that's fine. It was just more.
No. I mean, when most of all the experiments we performed were like performed at controlled room temperature. So we haven't really studied the effect of temperature. Of course, I think if you reduce the temperature a lot, their motion will probably goes down a lot, and then probably they will not form any waves.
Thank you, Leida. Lucy, would you like to ask your question?
Yes. Hi, Anton. I just wanted to ask, what range of drop sizes have you tried?
So as I show it here, typically, so here I show you from approximately 100 to 1 milliliter. So 1 milliliter is probably the biggest droplets that will fit on a glass slide. So we never got higher than that. And probably the smallest droplets that we tried were around 50 microliter. If the droplets is even smaller, the diameter is so small that actually the nematodes just don't have any space left to oscillate and form the metachronal wave. So like this range, the minimum range is essentially limited by the size availability for the nematode to oscillate. And what is the highest size, we don't really know. However, we expect that if the size of the droplets become very big, there will be defects in the formation of the metachronal wave. We have actually seen defects even for this biggest droplets. I can probably show you a video here. So this is 750 microliter droplets, and you see sometimes there is defects forming. So you see here the nematodes, the wave is moving in opposite directions. There is a wave that moves in this direction here. And in the bottom, there is a wave that moves in opposite direction. So for very high droplets, we expect that there will be defect in the waves.
Okay, great. Thank you.
I have a question. In your experiment of the four droplets evaporating, the ones with higher concentration of nematodes were not evaporating as fast, or how does the volume compare among droplets?
No. The one with the highest concentration evaporate the fastest. You can see that it goes the fastest. It will evaporate the fastest. So we don't yet know exactly why the droplets with the nematodes evaporate faster. We could suppose that this is because the surface is bigger, because here the surface shrink and here the surface supposedly not shrink. But actually, if I measure directly the surface of each of these droplets, I actually find that they're essentially all the same. And so the surface is actually not the explanation of why these droplets evaporate faster. So we don't yet know why they evaporate faster.
No, thanks.
Can I ask a question? I'm curious about this evaporation, and you were showing sort of the top-down views of the nematode swirling around the edge, and then there was another high-density cluster in the middle. Mm-hmm. Is that maintained throughout evaporation?
So you mean the cluster in the center?
Yeah.
No, so as I said, these clusters are not stable in time. They can appear. They don't always appear, they often appear, but they can appear and they can disappear in time, and we don't know we haven't yet studied their dynamics, and we don't yet know why they're formed and what is controlling their dynamics. This is something that we yet need to study.
Okay, so if you are evaporating the droplet, sometimes there's a cluster in the middle and sometimes
there is no cluster, okay. And sometimes it's form and then disappear and reappear again, etc. So it's very different. We don't know yet.
So the droplet doesn't shrink because the nematodes are pushing the borders outside.
So this is our hypothesis, that the nematodes produce a force that's push on the side that prevents the droplet from shrinking. Actually, I have not shown you today, but we have a video of an extremely high density of nematodes I think it was more than 150 nematodes per microliter. And we have actually seen that the nematodes and the mechanical wave was able to push the droplets, actually increase for some time the diameter of the droplets. So if
you put that droplet at the interface of a glass slide that is half coated hydrophilic and half hydrophobic, would that droplet would be moved, like self-propelled?
I don't think so, because on the non-heterophobic surface, the droplet, the liquid, essentially attached to the surface, so it will be probably hard to move it. But I think the site, okay, the site which was created with the heterophobic solution will, of course, the site should shrink much faster than the site which is not treated with the heterophobic solution. That's yes. But I don't think the droplet itself will move.